Ladies, gentlemen, one and all, welcome to the fourth installment of the More Cans Ain't Wise podcast, where James and I are striving to normalise drinking at home alone during the lockdown. The lockdown might be easing, but our drinking is not. We're ramping it up every week, and such, the quality should ramp up with it of this podcast. James, how are you doing, pal?
Good, mate. Hi, everybody. Looking forward to this week. Should be good.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're like proper professionals now, aren't we?
Yeah, I was going to say the quality claim could be interesting, but we'll have to see.
Well, the thing is that we're doing this different every week in one way or another. And so last week, thank you very much to Toby for joining us. This week, we're just on our own. And we thought we'd do absolutely minimal prep this week just to see what we can get away with, didn't we?
Yeah, then basically the long-term plan is that if we do minimal prep and it works, we can just tell people we're working really hard on stuff.
Yeah, should we edit this bit out?
We should probably just start again.
Yeah, okay, now we'll keep this in. So, what are we here to do today? James, how's your week been, first of all?
Yeah, it's been good, mate.
Yeah?
Nothing too serious, mate. Still missing work, but...
Yeah. Any to talk on when you're going to be back?
Yeah, well, I think we're looking at hopefully next week sometime for takeaway stuff, and then 4th of July is the big date everyone's got in for...
Independence Day.
Yeah, mate. Independence Day, hopefully.
Perfect. Well, this week I got to know my body quite well. On Monday, I went into work with an old like work T-shirt, rubbed my nipple a bit, so I put parcel tape on my nipple, which you know, I've got sensitive skin, so I had a reaction. Still not gone down now, so that's not ideal. I had very bad sunburn after all this nice weather, because I've got very fair skin as well as sensitive skin.
The way to avoid sunburn is not going outside, mate. I've found that.
Yeah, well, you know when it's windy and so you get a bit of windburn and then it's cloudy so you don't realise you're getting sunburn and then you come home and you look like you've been at the cenotaph all day with your arm in the air and you've got like a permanent white T-shirt on just because your arms are red.
I mean, again, it's a problem. The problem could be solved by not going outside, mate. That's where
I'll tell you a problem that can't be solved by not going outside, which is my problem three. I have a theory or a realization. I, for years, didn't know why it was known as getting arseholed when you drink so much. Do you know?
Oh, well, I imagine if it's literally, then you could be in a bit of trouble recording this, mate.
Yeah, so I've been drinking quite a lot and I have developed piles. So, yeah.
That's so sad. And if you're sticking with us after that, then I congratulate you.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's my week, mate. It's been all right.
Yeah, I mean, it went from steady and took a very downhill turn pretty quickly, that, mate.
Yeah, try being me. Actually, I'm not selling it to anyone, am I?
Piling on the jokes here, mate.
Right, so we're going to do our, as always, we're going to do our weekly beer review. What have we chosen here?
So we've gone for, mate, we're talking, obviously the first few episodes, Landlord, classic strong pale ale.
Yeah.
We did Punk IPA, which is more of a modern style IPA. And I thought the way to kind of move it on is we'd go down the sour or goes route. So we've gone for Salty Kiss. This is Magic Rock Huddersfield. We've kind of gone for quite a Yorkshire-based theme for the brewery spotlight as well. So kind of in theme, it's Magic Rock, been around since 2011. I think this is their best beer, Salty Kiss. So it's a Gooseberry Goes.
What is a Goes?
So yeah, I was going to get onto that. So a Goes, the traditional way of a Goes, it's a German beer.
Yeah.
So more than half of the grain. In when it's made, when it's fermented, has to be wheat.
Yeah.
And when they ferment it, you either add salt artificially or the salt in the brewing process. And so what you end up with the beer is a sour style beer, but also with a high salt content.
Okay. That doesn't sound appetizing.
It doesn't. But when you match it with fruit, for example, this is a Gooseberry Goes.
Mm.
So you get gooseberries, quite sour, like sour bitter flavour anyway. You match that with the lemon, the citrus, and the salt.
Yeah.
Quite a refreshing beer. Like, Gose's tend never to be more than 4 or 5%, really.
And right, okay.
You know, and even though there is hops in it, there isn't really a big hop smell or a big hop taste. So what you actually end up with is, like, nearly all the citrus, nearly all the fruit.
Okay.
Rather than when we've been talking about IPAs and stuff in, before, which have been the big hop flavours, the big Americans, the big Kiwi hop flavours that you'll get in an IPA or a pale.
Okay. So
what you should get drinking on it is, smell-wise, quite a clean smell. And then tasting-wise, big hit of citrus. You get that salt almost to balance that. I think it's really refreshing. And I think it's goes, you'll see quite a lot used as a base for other flavours. Like in this case, it's gooseberry. But you've got quite a big springboard to do whatever you want with a goes. So
I've never had one of these before. And looking at the can, for those who haven't seen it before, it looks like a goth's pencil case from school. It's got like a lot of pink and black going on. It's it looked to me like it was going to be something quite fruity and sweet. And then everything that you've said then has worried me about this beer. So I gave it a little smell. And I'm just going to dig in here.
Yeah. I mean, sours and goes is, whilst you're trying that, sours and goes do split opinion. But I think there are some fantastic beers out there. And it's just a great framework for going to town on flavours. I love it as a game. This particular goes as a classic. Very popular. Last five, six, 7 years has been super popular, this beer.
I think if I'd have tried this before episode one, before the conquest to try every beer that there is, I think if I'd have tried it then, I would have absolutely hated it. As it turns out, I only minorly hate it. It's it's quite horrible to me.
Yeah, it's it's definitely an acquired taste, and I did want to kind of cover it early.
Yeah,
because a lot of breweries now, like our can of the day yesterday, for example, that we posted on our Instagram.
Yeah,
from Arbidale was a sour IPA. And a lot of people are using that style and mixing styles for whatever. So a lot of the beers that you get offered now, there will be your classic IPAs, your pales, your milds, your stouts, etc. But most breweries now will either specialise in or will at least offer a sour or a goes.
I have never seen a sour on draft, I don't think.
Yeah, going to the wrong place. Yeah, there's some great places out there. I mean, it is a very speciality thing. I mean,
the second sip was much better.
Yeah, I mean, it is a bit of a shock to the system.
Yeah,
you are expecting sweet, to be fair, to balance hops out.
Yeah,
but with that lack of hot flavour, you just get all the citrus.
So, I think I can see that.
I mean, for me personally, like, I think it's like, food matching stuff is great with it. I think it's a good palate cleanser. I think you're probably not going to have it in the same amount of volume as an IPA or a pale or a
No, pot. this is nice. I mean, the little cans that we have. I tell you what, I just keep sipping it as you keep going, and I'm doing a mental U-turn. It's delicious. How fickle am I? I can see what you mean by refreshing. Like, how could sour be refreshing? But then you drink it. I think a lot of it is knowing what you're about to drink and how to drink it.
Of course. And I would also say that this particular goes, on a modern scale, is probably a 2 or a 3 out of 10 in terms of sourness.
Oh, okay. I thought you meant in terms of, like, taste.
No. Taste.
U-turns.
Taste is... I think this is again a great gateway to. I think that's what we've been trying to do for the first at least half a dozen beer reviews, is give people a gateway or a first step into certain styles of beer.
Yep.
And if you like this, then I mean, you can push even further. I mean, if you don't quite like the sour aspect, the other beer that I would recommend from the same brewery, Magic Rock, is High Wire.
Okay.
That's a grapefruit IPA. So you still get the big hot bitterness, but you also get the grapefruit fruit. So you get a little bit of citrus, a little bit of bitterness. So I'd recommend that if this is a little bit too far for you. But in terms of sours and stuff, this is a good platform to go, really. I really like it.
You can get it in the, is it £3 for £5 deal at Marks and Spencer? That's the supermarket you can find this one in.
Yeah, we were having a look, weren't we? I mean, other Magic Rock stuff is available. Sorcery.
That is one of my favourite beers. I mean, I've got a little list here of what I've tried this week and how they made me feel. And Sorcery is named just right because it is a magic beer.
And Cannonball is the other for me, which is their IPA. And they also do stronger double IPAs and double hopped.
This is something I was really wanting to ask. What is a double IPA?
Well, it depends on definition.
What is the definition?
So it depends on hop content or or the way in which it's fermented and brewed.
Because they tend to be stronger, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, yes. So, and also like the sort of either longer fermentation or higher hop content. I mean, the big thing now is double dry hop. So if you see DDH,
yes,
adding extra dry hops to beers.
I mean, it's more chemistry.
So more for fermentation, higher ABV. So it is much more of a modern thing because the way IPA started, why they're called Indian Pales,
yeah,
is that they had a high hop content because they had to last a long time on ships.
Okay.
So the hop content keeps the beer from going off.
Yeah.
So what it leads to two things. So it leads to one is that bitter hoppy flavour.
Yeah.
But it also leads to sometimes a slightly higher ABV. I mean, modern beer techniques now means you can adapt that to whatever you need to be. So IPA's kind of gone into this blanket term as pale ales, but traditionally you are looking for a high content, hot flavoured, like a modern palate now loves that hop content. So breweries dash to do doubles and triples and whatever they can because that's what's in vogue at the moment, the big hop hitting high ABV pales.
I don't know about you, but I'd really like to avoid the high ABV.
I'm probably the opposite in terms of
being able to handle your beer. You're definitely the opposite of me.
I don't know if that's criticism or
100% a compliment.
Compliment.
I envy it so much.
I think you've just got to think of it, and this is what I say quite a lot when people look at keg or can prices or whatever. If you compare it to wine, and you treat it like wine. We were talking before about halves and schooners, like 2/3 of pints.
Yeah.
If you do treat it like that, and you have an 8, 9, 10, even 11%,
I suppose
the barley wine stuff, like you can enjoy. You can enjoy that like you would a glass of wine.
But I so rarely sit in and drink pint after pint of wine.
Well, that's a lie.
Yeah, no, I've got an 11% stout downstairs, but, you know, sort of need to big myself up in order, like, you know, G myself up before I drink it.
Yeah, it's not a Wednesday morning beer, is it?
Could I run some more beers by you that I've tried this week?
Yeah.
So I discovered that the local supermarket to here, another posh one, Booths, they've got establishments all over the north. But I don't know where your nearest one is.
Mainly next to the M&S in Ben's Toryland.
Toryland next to Waitrose.
Yeah.
Right, so Seven Brothers Honeycomb, 4%. Absolutely wonderful.
Mate, so we were chatting this week about that. I mean, Jimmy's in Manchester used to have it as their house beer. Steve at Al's Dime Bar, Al's Star Bar, have that as one of their house beers.
Phenomenal.
Phenomenal, a little bit sweet, but I'm going to say this about a lot of beers.
It's not overpowering, though, I don't think.
Yeah,
it's subtle.
I 100% get that. And what I like about Seven Brothers is, similar to Tiny Rebel, is that when they say they produce a beer which is of a certain flavour, they usually nail that flavour profile every time. Like, it isn't that honeycomb pale isn't anything else once you've tried it. Like, It is a delicious pale with honeycomb. Like,
yeah.
There's no other like mitigating flavors or whatever there. I think it's a delicious beer.
Have you had Hamerton Crunch?
I have not.
Peanut butter milk stout. Ah, right. Well, it looks like a breakfast cereal, and I have nothing more to say other than I liked it.
I mean, we have tried peanut butter milk stout, haven't we? It's a very once you're in that cul-de-sac. They are very similar, aren't they? I think I probably have half a dozen different peanut butter milk stouts over the last year or so.
Yeah.
And they all are very, very similar. Belching Beaver's good. We've focused on that before.
Want to praise that every week.
Tailgate, fantastic. So yeah, there are a few out there. It's, as I say, I think once you've tried one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel what you're saying. Oh, how about this for a snake in the grass, right? So your friend of mine, Cloudwater Brewery, they've paired up with BrewDog. And I noticed this when I was in Tesco. I saw the can, this New England IPA. Are you aware of it?
I'm not, mate.
Oh, right. Okay. Right. So I saw this can and it had neutral colours on it, your greens, your blues. Cloudwater, I associated with your 3.2% when I go to the pub, you know. That's just, rightly or wrongly, that might have just been what was on when I used to go.
I was gonna say that's a wild swing from that.
I'm here to make sweeping statements and upset people accidentally who really like beer.
And he's all dum-dum doing sweeping statements.
I've not even started yet. Yeah. So anyway, right. So anyway, this can. I mean, it was one of the larger cans. You know, instead of your 330, it's your how big's this?
440
is
the tall boy.
Your tall boy 440. And yeah, so anyway, I'm sat outside, Beck's on the phone, and I'm just enjoying this can to myself, maybe have a couple. And it didn't really occur to me to check what the ABV was until I'd started ringing my sister and various other friends to say how much I loved them. And I didn't realise it was 6.8%, and I was essentially doing pint after pint of Desperados by myself.
Nice.
Which made for a good Saturday.
I'm sure Beth was delighted, mate.
To be fair, she was. We had a really good time. Oh, we've had a cracker of a weekend. I'll tell you what really does actually improve the mood when I'm absolutely steaming is if we're playing darts at the same time. You know, when I'm missing the board with all three, throwing it down the little like alleyway by the side of my house, hitting the tandem instead of hitting the board. Yeah, that tends to make darts a lot more enjoyable for both of us.
I was about to say, when you were saying about darts, I was going to be like, we should 100% go to Flight Club when it opens in Leeds. But if you're missing the board,
well, yeah, if you're against me, then that's sound. You know, it's like bowling. You want to go bowling with someone.
Oh, I'm not bothered about winning. It was more about getting a deposit back, mate, if I'm honest.
I won't be the worst one there, I don't think. I've been practicing a lot. But yeah, also, at Flight Club, they don't do round the world, do they? You have to actually get good scores.
Oh, I'm doing. I'm assuming you could do what you wanted, but
I mean, for the price, you probably should be able to. But let's not them, because we like them. Have you tried any beers this week? These are all new to me.
Yeah, I had a bit of a. I've not tried anything new. I mean, I had a delivery from North Brew.
Yeah,
that arrived early in the week, so some session IPAs. Our beer of the day today is.
Yeah.
A session IPA from them, Pinata, which is a classic, which we featured before, a guava tropical pale. But other than that, I've been pretty boring, I think. Goose midway sessions run off for Asda, so I'd some of them.
Does that come in a bottle?
These were in tall boy cans, 440s.
Right. Okay. I love a bit of Goose IPA, yeah, but I've not ventured outside apart from a bottle that came with Beer 52.
So, yeah, so the Midway session, Midway's just Chicago where it's from, is the session version of their pails. It's 4142.
Yeah.
But delicious, easy drinking beer. It was great, yeah. Great in the garden the last couple of days.
Should we go on to something that's a bit less easy to talk about?
Why not?
Why not, indeed. Why right, not? So after, you know, we're talking about how professional we are every time we sort of talk about ourselves. We forgot to say what the top three is for this week, last episode, because in our haste doing the Guinness game, you know, we just get overexcited, don't we? So this week we've decided to go for top three things that we think are overrated. Very subjective. There's going to be a lot of sweeping statements, but do you want to kick us off with something that you think is overrated?
Yeah, I'm going to apologise. I mean, it was hard for me to narrow mine down from a lot to three, so I will shout some out at the end.
I wanted to do that, like a credits list at the end. Those who didn't make it this year.
I've got like 10 in front of me, and I've whittled it down to three. So my first, number three, the TV show Friends.
Right. Okay. There's a pause in the podcast here. Whilst we're just going to have a discussion as to why we're never, ever, ever going to say that. We're going to edit it out. That's wrong. No, James, I wasn't being serious. Like
the TV show Friends.
Oh, I've got to edit this now. Go on.
I think it's one of the worst TV shows ever made.
I think it's one of the best TV shows ever made. It stands up.
It doesn't age well. I don't think the characters are very good. Like, I think, like, it's very, very one-dimensional in the jokes it says. I just think it's a very basic, like, it's an average TV show.
But it's not, it's aiming to be the average TV show. It's like, oh, Coronation Street, you know, it's not that gripping, is it? The actors are a bit shit. But it's like, it keeps you watching. It's just enough to keep you watching. You can tune in at any episode and just, I didn't think I felt this strongly about this, but I'm sweating.
Well, I mean, I understand why people like it. I just don't understand why it's the most watched sitcom of all time, and it's having reunions and whatever. So that is my number three, my friend.
My friend, to add insult to injury. my third one is also a TV show that I think's overrated. I don't suppose you've been watching Normal People, have you?
I haven't, no.
Right, so Sally Rooney, I think her name is, has written a book about these two kids who are in love-ish, but they're in Ireland. They can't admit... I've watched an episode, right? So I'm making a really broad statement about something I don't know about, which I do all the time on this. But basically, I tuned in on a hangover whilst Beck was watching, and it's just... You're watching two 17-year-olds shag each other, and I'm thinking, where has the world gone wrong that is entertainment that we can actually, like, get behind? And I mean, I know they're Irish, so they're probably, you know, it's all legal. You can watch that. They can do whatever they want. But it's just, I don't understand people's fascination.
I mean, this is probably a conversation you want to have with Beck rather than me and all our listeners, to be fair. Like, this is a show that I've never seen. I mean, it does sound pretty wild.
What pisses me off, right, is it's this, this Irish enigma. I can't do the voice. But it's like, I can't tell you that I love you, because even though I do love you, I'm not going to tell my mates, you know. And it just seems so cliche. And then they start banging, and then they don't see each other for a while. And then she's upset, but she's not upset to him. And then they start banging again. And you're like, speaking about one-dimensional, James, this is unnecessarily three-dimensional. It's something I don't want to see.
I mean, the one thing I would say is that this show, which I've already forgotten the name of, You have to look for it to find it, don't you?
Like child pornography.
Like Friends, on the other hand, it's there all the time.
Okay.
I wouldn't say your program is over or underrated. It sounds probably unnecessary.
It's very, very popular. I mean, she's written a best-selling book, which it's based on. I think a lot of people will have watched it who are listening, and a lot of people who haven't seen it and then start listening based on what I've said, just take yourselves directly to jail. Do not pass go.
Do not collect £200.
Do not collect £200. Oh, I can't believe I've said some of the words I've said. So, right, number two.
Unnecessarily good cars.
What if someone works really hard and thinks I fancy a Ferrari?
What's the point? And like, seriously, what is the point? Like,
0 to 60, mate, 3.4.
That you can't do anywhere on any road.
I mean, there's no reason why you'd be going 0 on the motorway, is there, at any point? So you don't need to. There's no traffic lights or junctions.
And also, like, those are the people that crash cars, that put insurance up. It's just a madness. Everyone should drive the Ford.
Go on. Communism.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, rip off my Jeremy Corbyn mask. Toyota Yaris.
Everyone has a Toyota Yaris.
When you have one kid, you move to like a Saab estate, and then two kids.
We're not doing very well. We need some English cars here, mate. Or we're.
You're gonna go and smash some statues up, mate.
I've got the sunburn to prove it.
Yeah,
I mean, everybody who listens to this knows us, so they'll know that that is not the case. I wasn't at the Cenotaph because I'm scared of fighting and I don't believe what they're into.
I'm glad you added that, because you can't just put, I was scared of fighting. I 100% believe in what they're campaigning for, but I'm just scared of going.
I feel sorry for these people, you know? Like, there's a lot of people likening them to Nazis, which I think is stupid, because it's just like, completely lurching from one end of the scale to the other. But there's people who are on the TV who genuinely believe that Winston Churchill killed Hitler.
Yeah, it's also like, it is an indictment on the British education system.
That's exactly what it is. Glorifying, you know, World War II and making it a British victory, against the common enemy.
For me, I just don't see why the two things can't be different. Like, you can praise Churchill for the role he had in the war and certain policies that he introduced,
whilst also being anti-racist.
I struggle to see where people have a difficulty with that, because It should be the case that you can look at somebody's character and judge them for the whole body of work, and it doesn't mean that somebody's inherently bad or whatever, especially somebody that was born over 100 years ago, nearly 120 years ago. Like, it's, for me, like...
The what-if brigade in the media, you know, saying like, oh, well, what if they were this? What if they were that? What if we're... Just fuck off, you know. It just doesn't sit right, does it?
Yeah, and the further the scary part about it is that the further we go down this is the left or the right or whichever camps, however you want to describe them.
Yeah.
As it escalates, you actually move away from the fundamental things that have happened. And this was started as a Black Lives Matter thing with George Floyd.
Yeah.
And we're 10 days or 2 weeks later now, and nothing's connected to that anymore. We're talking about Churchill's legacy and all types of other stuff whilst there's a pandemic on. It's crazy.
I don't think we're gonna get any laughs out of this bit.
It's all right. Statues overrated.
You know what, statues are overrated, to be fair, because nobody reads the plaques, so I wouldn't know what a statue was all about in the middle of town.
I do like a football statue, though. I mean, Bobby Moore at Wembley's pretty cool. I'm not an Arsenal fan, but that Thierry Henry, one of the Emirates, is sick.
Michael Jackson outside Fulham.
Oh, mate, number one, GOAT. even pain.
I bet he'd enjoy normal people.
Yeah. Well, he was a character, wasn't he?
Yeah, but we can't.
I should have put him, actually, Michael Jackson, overrated.
No. Come on. No. His music. You don't enjoy his music?
Doesn't age well.
What? Billie Jean doesn't age well?
That's a tune.
You were talking about how disco music was still all right and you'd listen to it from time to time. If you can entertain the Bee Gees, you can entertain Michael Jackson, some of his big hits.
I can't entertain the Bee Gees, though. There's some good disco music without it being the Bee Gees.
Not in my head.
Oh, did Barry Gibb write it? No, not disco. John Travolta dance to it? No, not disco. It's not like that, right?
Oh, man.
That's Podcasts are two key comebacks, aren't they, on this podcast? Disco music and Shrovetide football.
Yeah, well, I don't know how we're going to tie this into Shrovetide football, but we'll find a way. There's also another little Easter egg that we're going to plant in every episode, and that is the mention of one of our friends, which I'll do later on, begrudgingly, but it's happening.
I mean, that's probably something that we say we'll do and then
won't. Oh, I'm going to forget. So, yeah. Right, now we're talking. We are talking. You said, like, lavish cars, unnecessarily lavish cars.
Yes.
I'm saying over-expensive, lavish meals. Going out for a fucking 50 quid main and a £45 starter and a bottle of wine that you can't afford. It just, you're gonna get a meal either way. So, I mean, the only time this has ever happened to me, because I never really go out of my way to go and eat food that I can't afford, is I tried to take Em out, my sister, for her 21st birthday in London. And so we went to try and find a restaurant called the Duck and Waffle. And the only way I could describe this building, because I'm rubbish at London, is when you went to it and you went to the floor that we thought you were supposed to go to.
Oh, it's on like the 50th floor is the Duck and Waffle, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. Because we got in the lift, which was a scary affair because I'm scared of tall buildings. Come at me. And we went up there, and then you want to save face. So if you do get the wrong floor in the Sushi Samba building, you've got a queue for ages to get down a level to go to wherever you were supposed to be. So we were really high up, and we went in there, and I mean, I'm a proud guy. I think most guys are. So they sat us to a table, and I was looking at the menu, and she said, the waitress, she said, "Can I get you any drinks while you wait?" And I was like, I should just sort of looked at the menu and then looked at Em and said, no. Like, did that really subtle way you sort of jerking to say no without shaking your head. And so I said, "No, we'll just have a bit of air water for the table, please." I look at the menu. And I mean, people who have been might be able to actually like falsify this. But for one individual sushi roll, it was 45 quid. I couldn't actually find anything on there. Usually it's trying to find something that I like. Here, it was trying to find a main that we could share that I could afford. So, I mean, your pride goes out the window, especially, well, not on a, in a building so high because that would be terrifying. But like, you know, we went and we ran on the free water that we were given. And the thing about running away from a table that high in the air is you've got to wait for the lift. And so then it was really cringy. The waitress came over and was like, "Excuse me, are you guys okay? You've not had, sorry, we don't have a reservation here." She's like, "No, it's fine, just sit down." No, it's fine. Went all the way back down to the bottom and Nando's was just shutting about a few roads away, because obviously I Googled where Nando's was, big up Nando's. And because they were shutting, they had a load of food left over. And so we actually got most of it for free. And it was a bit like going downstairs on the Titanic. It was like, why be up there with all of those, you know, posh knobheads who look good in Instagram pictures when you can have a phone which has a crack down the little lens on your camera so you can't actually commemorate the time. And you can have some really nice, you know, peri-peri chicken. And then you can go for a load of beers and barely even remember the meal anyway.
I mean, you have rescued it with the last sentence. I think I'm all for the working class vibe, I've got to say.
Well, you've just been talking about boots. I've got to bring it back.
Yeah. But I have got to defend the nice places to eat. It can be a treat, can't it? I mean, I do work in the trades, obviously.
In what way is getting a portion smaller than that makes you full and paying over the odds for it a good thing?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's obviously dependent on where you... If you go for a tasting menu, for example, like that can be...
Yeah, 12-course meal.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a reason I think it's overrated here. It's not my vibe.
I mean, I can totally get it as well. I think it is a very acquired.
Also, if anybody disagrees, feel free to give me a few hundred quid because you're obviously accustomed to wasting money.
My number one, mate. New Year's Eve.
You know what? Right. James Yates. James Yates, friend of the show. He said, New Year's Eve, the guy who comes up with the games. And I was going to say, I've got a note here. That isn't my number one, but it was meant to be.
Yeah, New Year's Eve.
Why? I've spent New Year's Eve with you, by the way.
Right, so I've worked it a lot. I've been out a lot. We had the boys over to Bradford when I had the flat in Bradford.
Yeah, that was good.
It was good, but I mean, I'm probably going to say some cliche things about like once a year drinkers and struggling to get to the bar and all that stuff. Personally, Christmas Eve, for example, is a lot better drinking day than New Year's Eve.
I'll edit this out. That tapping you're doing, you can hear it.
What tapping?
Scraping or something? All right, we're good.
We're good, yeah? Yeah.
Oh, right, no, fair enough. Sorry.
Should I start with New Year's Eve?
Say New Year's Eve.
Yeah, so my number one, mate, New Year's Eve.
Yep. James Yates, yeah, friend of the show.
Let's start it again, but yeah, you need to be. So my number one, mate, is New Year's Eve.
Ah, right. No, I was going to say, right, this was going to be my number one because James Yates, friend of the show, got in touch and, I mean, he comes up with all the games and he's made me seem like I actually do anything on this, but actually I've just robbed his ideas. Yeah, the New Year's Eve effect, it is by its nature overrated.
I'm obviously going to say some cliche things about crowded bars and once a year drinkers. And obviously being both sides of the bar, I see it all.
Yeah.
It's just a strange one with no taxis.
Nope.
Places charging more money, like...
But they're selling the idea that it's one night and you've got to have a good time.
Like, and also, you can't not go out, can you?
No.
So, it means that there's a lot of people out who probably don't fancy being out. Like, Christmas Eve, for example, for us, like, where I'm from, is, like, a lot better drinking day.
Yeah.
Boxing Day after the football's a lot better drinking day. But they don't really get a mention. But New Year's Eve's kind of seen as this...
And getting charged to go into your local, that rubs you up the wrong way.
Yeah, it's tough times, isn't it? And also, you've got the back end of when you wake up, you've already broken your New Year's resolutions. and it's the 1st of January. And
yeah.
What's happening in January?
And you've upset everybody with that mistletoe belt that you always wear.
I mean, it was a tough time.
It was one time and no one will ever forget it. I'm not playing devil's advocate again, but I actually really like New Year's Eve. Apart from one year we went to that Hogmanay in Edinburgh and we decided what we'll do is we'll get the train there like one afternoon, like morning, get there in the afternoon, spend the day in Edinburgh and then come back the next day after, you know, all the fireworks and stuff. But unfortunately, just about everybody else in the whole world had that idea. And so you were queuing for a drink and then queuing for a piss and, you know, back and forth. I'm sure it would be lovely, but New Year's Eve, not the one.
Thanks for proving my point. I feel like we're getting somewhere.
I don't think we've ever agreed on anything on this.
So what's your, we are making baby steps, mate. What's your number one?
Right, this one is so overrated, and I think it's practiced more often than New Year's Eve. It's something that people with no idea about how to have a good time have a good time. And it's called a curry before a night out.
Wow. I've got a very interesting story about this.
Well, let me just start by saying that, I mean, I've been pretty open about, like, my struggles with... being able to control my bowels. And I need better ways of talking about it because I tried to think of something. Anyway, so I don't want to be going and trying to have the spiciest curry I can possibly handle in front of a bunch of lads, you know, because that's what you do. Nobody wants to be the korma guy. And if you're the korma guy, no one wants you to be out anyway. But I don't know. I go for something that I shouldn't. And then the whole rest of the night, I'm in turmoil. You know, nightclub toilets, but even bar toilets, like a lock on the door, a toilet seat, and toilet paper, pick one. You know, like that's essentially how it is.
The Venn diagram of those three and nothing in the middle.
Yeah, well, there's nothing in the middle. I heard a funny story off my mate Charles, actually, at the other day. He was saying that he's been in a bar where you could pay to rent a toilet seat off the guy who sells the aftershaves. That is why you don't have a curry before a night out. What's your story?
So, I'm only banned from one pub in the world. And it's just shout out to the Hayworth Arms in Hull.
Oh, yes.
Old Boys 2010. Hayworth Arms, sponsor our lacrosse club.
Yeah, it's where we had our socials.
Yeah. So I'm the president. I've organised the weekend or whatever. We've organised a curry, because that's what everyone said they wanted to do. And then we're doing our standard drinking circle.
Yeah.
So all I'm going to say is curry plus 40 lads drinking a dozen pints each after a curry.
Yeah.
Equals mess that we probably don't need to talk about.
Shit time had by all, and also the effects were felt by the establishment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, I think that's the last time. It's 10 years ago. That's the last time I've ever done a curry before a night out.
Okay. I was banned for life from that pub as well.
It's interesting characters that ran it, weren't they?
I wouldn't blame them. It's just that I celebrated a goal overzealously and knocked a light fitting off the ceiling. But it was a Man United goal and they're few and far between. So, like, it was good times.
Oh, yeah. Especially late Fergie, early Moisey.
Oh, apart from the, yeah. Sad times.
I've got a list of some of the things that came very close.
Oh, yes. I reckon we might have written some of the same things. Like, these are ultra cliche, I'm imagining.
So mine are Starbucks.
I don't drink any hot drinks, so hot drinks is mine.
Facebook.
Yeah, Facebook. Deleted Facebook. Never looked back.
The sport of rugby union.
I also, right, so some of our Twitter followers have, like, rugby union fan in their bio, so I didn't want to say that, but yeah, I've got that written down as well.
Newspapers.
Just newspapers.
Newspapers. Star Wars.
Whoa.
This is the hill that I'll choose to die on. It's not any good.
What, at all? Like, any of it?
Like, it's all right, but why do people queue for... Why do people watch them all in a row or queue for a day to see it, or there has to be 5 trailers for it? I don't get it.
Do you know what bends my mind? When it's like, oh yeah, the cartoon film they made, that's the best one. And you're like, you what? It's a cartoon about fictional space aliens. And it, all right. Yeah, I sort of see what you mean. I can't keep up. I think it's overrated, like all these Avengers and things like that, where they make 30 films in 4 years and you've got to try and keep up with it all. Like, yeah, how?
That's a tough thing for me. Like, I like some of them because you can just put them on, and films that you can put on for 2 hours and switch your brain off are great.
Yeah.
But it's when you have to track who's killed who and whatever. Like.
Yeah, they follow on from each other in a way that they're not released in the right order, but you've got to work out yourself what order they're released in. I mean, I am actually working my way through them in a chronological order, and I've got to Iron Man 3, so, but I think they're overrated at this point.
My last one.
Yeah, go on.
Jam.
Jam?
Yeah.
Well, like, are you ultra team marmalade or chutney?
Chutney's okay. Marmalade's very average.
Right, if you can tell me the difference between a jam and a marmalade.
Well, this is what I'm saying. I don't like either. Like, I don't get it. I don't understand how people can have that on toast and that be an adequate breakfast. Like, in your arsehole for breakfast, you've got egg, sausage, bacon, black pudding.
Yeah, egg always needs to be accompanied by meat for me. I think it's disappointing if it's not. If you have egg and beans, it's not quite, yeah.
Egg and beans, not for me. I can't have them touching.
Oh, you like that? So there's you talking about Mr. Fine Dining and you can't have your eggs and beans touching. What if Gordon Ramsay puts them together? What then?
Well, he won't, because he's a good chef. Well, that's a pretty simple answer, isn't it, mate?
I've got to be honest, you just absolutely dispatched me then.
Yeah, it's jam. Like, jam and scones and high tea. Afternoon tea.
Afternoon tea, cannot be arsed with that. The only time I can actually appreciate afternoon tea, don't drink hot drinks, again, don't care what you think, is when they drive around, you know, the buses around London?
Yeah.
they have the afternoon tea on wheels. I can appreciate that because I think there's booze happening.
Oh, like a bottomless afternoon tea. I've seen those. But then I think Prosecco's overrated, so...
Prosecco's overrated, but I have champagne written here, which is overrated to the highest degree, I think. So, you know, when you're celebrating, you hear that cork pop, you think, 45 quid, 45 quid. I didn't realise how tight I was. I keep saying 45 quid about things.
I've got a lot of champagne splits opinion for me. Taste-wise, average, not good. Like image and memories, pretty high.
Like, so it could get a bottle of Prosecco. It tastes the same.
Oh yeah, 100%, 100%.
So yeah, champagne was legit on my list. So what else have we got? Yeah, hot drinks. Rock climbing. Rock climbing is severely overrated because for anybody who, you know, if you're an amateur rock climber, you maybe go once or twice a year. You're paying 15 quid and your arms get knackered after about 5 minutes. You know. I mean, there's probably techniques. You probably should use your feet and stuff as well. But stone.
Yeah, there's imagery hanging off by one hand.
Yeah, I want to look like. Feet. Yeah, just to get the Instagram picture and then leave. Stone Island clothing.
Oh, interesting, Stone Island.
A shitty little semi-sewed on logo makes somebody hard as nails all of a sudden. And then the very easy to peel off logo, if you go and peel it off, you know, nothing's going to happen because they're not hard as nails anymore. They've not got the logo.
There are some nice jackets they make, but yeah, I would never buy one.
What I actually have issue with, to be honest, is the fact that they don't sew the label on properly. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's done at either side. That's their thing, though, isn't it? Everyone has to have their thing.
But having a thing like shoddy... Right, anyway, well, yeah, that's overrated for me. And finally, and I think this is probably the most polarizing, I think I'll be on my own with this one, to be honest. Chinese takeaway. Massively overrated. Could easily never have one ever again.
I mean, you do know what I do for a living. Like, for anyone who doesn't know, I run the bar at a Chinese restaurant and takeaway. So I feel like this is a direct shot at me.
Well, you got to defend yourself.
You don't like any Chinese at all?
I love it. When I eat it, it's great. However, a little thing called MSG just happened to pop up that made making Chinese taste nice a whole lot cheaper. And I thought, you know what? If we put shitloads in, we'll get no return business, but we could just charge loads of money for essentially sugar and chicken. And you know, they'll get really dry mouth. They won't be able to sleep. You know what? They'll probably get up at 4:30 and need to go for about 4 pints of water and then have to do it again about 2 hours later. But, you know, it's all about the money. So maybe I'm taking issue with just our local Chinese that I had like not too long ago. But yeah, Chinese takeaway, overrated.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to defend it, but I feel like it's now on me to take you somewhere nice that you would enjoy.
Death to MSG.
We say that, but then we'll drink booze with all the sugar and all the booze in it in the world. So, well,
speaking of drinking booze, right? So, I mean, we've got, as always, we've got the brewery spotlight later on. And I got quite a few beers in for that because I got overexcited with the booze shop. And so, yeah, I've actually been piling through them. So that's why the sweeping statements are coming thick and fast.
I've got a lot of time for it. I mean, we can move on to vocation now, actually. I mean, okay. I've just ruined the surprise.
Well, no, you haven't, because everybody will already have seen on the social medias that we were going to do this. Because I couldn't find the salt. Was it salt brewing? Are they called salt brewing?
Yeah, so salt will be over the next couple of weeks.
I couldn't find it in the shop. So I sent James a picture of what I was looking at in Tesco. And he said, right, vocation this week. We'll do vocation. So bought 3 cans. Vocation, vocation, vocation. Thought I'd done an absolute worldie of a tweet. Tagged Phil and Kirsty in it from location, location, location. And would you believe it? They didn't even get back to me. Not even a like.
Just throw it on, don't you? Just throw a little like on, don't you?
Exactly. Just acknowledge that I've gone to the effort to type something.
It's a 10-second job.
Sophie Ellis-Bexter liked a tweet I sent to her once.
I think they have to be on the top of our enemies list, don't they, to be fair?
Phil and Kirsty, definitely.
One and two.
Yeah.
If you're listening,
can we have Michael Jackson at number three?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. Phil Kirsty, well. Michael Jackson.
So, Vocation.
Yes, tell me about Vocation. Where are they from? What do they do?
Hebden Bridge.
Where is Hebden Bridge?
So, Hebden Bridge, West Yorkshire.
Ah, okay, yeah. Halifax postcode.
It is, yeah. So, it's if you were getting the train from Leeds or Bradford to Manchester, it's on that line.
Yep.
Kind of a very liberal, artsy village now, like a almost a commuter village for Leeds and Manchester.
Yeah.
Very nice, very pretty. Quite a lot of problems with flooding and stuff over the last few years, so you'll see it in the paper for news for flooding and stuff. I just wanted to talk about some of their beers, really. I think...
I've just come to a shocking realisation. So the beer that I'm drinking at the moment, which I've just knocked back in a few sips, is Life and Death, which is an ironically named beer, I think. It's 6.5%, and I didn't really realise. It's happened to me again.
it's a great beer, though, a great IPA. I kind of just wanted to bring you guys' attention to this, because I think when we started this, we wanted to give you guys an idea of beers that you could try in the supermarket.
Yeah.
And both Asda and Tesco and Morrison stock these beers. So if you're going out, Bread and Butter is their cask beer, their cask 3.8% pale. Like, that's their standard pale. But if you're in the supermarket, I picked up the Life and Death, which is an IPA.
Yeah.
6.5%, big hop hit with that one.
It's absolutely delicious. Like, even to those who don't drink a lot of these, like me, like I used to be, it's absolutely delicious, this Life and Death.
The Heart and Soul Session Pale Tropical. It's almost akin to the Club Tropicana we tried a couple of weeks ago. A little bit more mellow than that, so not as big a fruity hit, but still delicious. And then the one I'm currently drinking at the moment is the Pride and Joy, which is their pale.
Oh, yes, I've already been through that this episode.
So, I mean, they say they brand this as hoppy. I don't think it's overly hoppy. I think it's easy drinking for the percentage.
Yeah. I'd say that. Yeah, it was nice. It was a light, sort of refreshing beer.
I think of their beers for me at the moment in the cans, like, I would recommend the Life and Death. Like, it's a great modern style IPA. I just kind of wanted to draw your guys' attention to Vocation if you've not tried them before.
Yeah, definitely. The cans are all similar. And as you can tell with the names, I mean, they've got Pride and Joy, Life and Death, Love and Hate. They're sort of like quite snappily named. Quite enjoy that. The cans, they look nice. I'd definitely give them a go.
Yeah, lovely people as well. I think they make great beer. Give them a try and let us know what you think on the Twitter and Instagram. And thanks for everyone who's posted stuff over the last week.
Oh, yeah, making us seem legitimate. So we got picked up this week by a Twitter account with 11,600 followers who recommended our podcast. So you like you do, because we're decent people, not like Phil and Kirsty. Sort of chuck them a comment back and say thank you very much, and they were like, yeah, love your sound and all that sort of thing, nice to have some new voices in the industry. Obviously that went to our heads, and we've decided we're going to get Blazers after 1,000 downloads. We currently stand at 236. We did get that initial 36 after the first episode, so I mean, exponentially we're growing, aren't we? So 1,000, we'll be having Blazers probably before September.
And if you fancy just putting us on and then muting us.
Oh, cannot recommend that enough. If you hate the show, if you absolutely hate what we're doing, just give us a listen on mute and give us a 5-star on Apple Music, and you never have to think about us ever again.
I can't say that enough. That's pretty much it. As long as we get the hour in, we don't care.
Could you tell me a bit about the beer that I've not opened yet, but this big boy that I've just realised is also 7.2%.
Which, is it the breakfast stout?
It's not, it's Love and Hate. It's a New England IPA. Didn't even realise that was a category.
So, New England, so it's, again, in terms of a lot of places will brand from the state, but it's more of a style.
Okay.
So your East Coast tends to be more traditionally single hop type IPAs.
Yeah.
So whereas your West Coast, that's where variations come in terms of bitterness levels, hazing on beers.
Oh, I like it. I like a hazy beer. If you can't see your fingers through it, I quite hate.
So anything that's New England, Vermont's quite a common one for this as well.
Yeah.
Will tend to be a more traditional style, East Coast American pale.
Right,
so they tend to be 4-6%, sometimes higher. Easy drinking. Again, with that bitterness, that hop, that pine. So,
yeah, I always just read the can while you're going just to see if I've got anything that I can sound intelligent about. But, it's just saying hazy and peach and mango aroma, which is it's actually what I aim for, personally.
We have to let us know because I've not got that in front of me. I'm drinking the Life and Death at the moment, the big IPA.
Just been through that. I do think I'm probably going to struggle to get through this whole episode at the rate I'm drinking. So, we've done our top three overrated things, and then we've gone into the brewery spotlight, so we're all good there. Now, I think we want to talk about something that's really important to both of us, something that we've missed over the last few weeks and months, but also it's been a bit of a celebration. Yes, we've been deprived of something we love, but I mean, this has been one of Burnley's most successful 3 months in modern times, hasn't it?
I mean, that's tough and that joke works, other than the fact we were on a 7-game unbeaten run before the... We've not lost since New Year's Day. So, I mean, I appreciate that joke. I am so buzzing for the football to be back.
Oh, mate. The fact that they've deprived us and then they're bringing it back again and then... This is what kills people, isn't it? It's when people go cold turkey and then have a mountain of whatever it is that they're trying to not do.
Oh, mate, if you look at my social media and a couple of posts I've made about football not being football without the fans and how it's a disgrace that football's come back and all this.
Yeah.
Like 6-8 weeks ago.
Yeah,
And then you contrast that to how I'm feeling now.
Oh, well, I mean, if everybody else is doing it, you know, it's... Also, you can pump the crowd noise in. Have you not seen on Sky Sports? You can have the option.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm a hypocrite. Let's be honest, I'm a hypocrite.
Oh, James, me too. I actually really enjoyed Normal People and Eat Curry Before a Night Out all the time. Actually, that's not true. I didn't enjoy Normal People.
So it's... I would... 100% be lying if I didn't say football's about the fans and the people who go and whatever, but then I'm the same guy that's going to be on a podcast saying I'm so buzzing to get me 16 Macca on at the weekend.
So maybe it's gambling that you've missed. I mean, I think the bookies are back open today, tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what they do. They've just been...
It's sort of socially distant anyway, be it going to the bookies, because there's a big plastic screen between you and them anyway.
You do tend to have the dregs of society in there, though, don't you? If anyone's going to have coronavirus, it's going to be the people that go to the bookies in city centres.
I disagree, because I think that you can smoke coronavirus away. I think there's people like, you know, like, is it Dot Cotton from EastEnders?
Tell me, mate.
Oh, well, she's basically a lady who's smoked forever and is still alive. And I think you can get to that level.
She played by June Brown?
Yeah. I think you can smoke yourself healthy if you're willing to push past all the other health problems, you know, affiliated with smoking.
All right, so almost kill yourself because that will kill everything that's bad in your body.
Precisely. You'll outlive everything in your body because it won't be able to outlive all the smoking. And I think June Brown is evidence of that.
Yeah, I've got a lot of time for that, I think.
I've got actually, if you want to hear the rest of the theory, I mean, if you look at all the Rolling Stones, I mean, Keith Richards, I've read his book. There's no way he should be alive. But then he is. he, you know, he didn't discriminate when he was putting things in his body. And I mean, he's never been diseased. The reason he gave up taking drugs was because he was so high on drugs in his 60s, he fell out of a tree and cracked his head open. And he thought, I probably got to slow down a bit. It wasn't anything to do with like his health.
Well, I mean, falling out of a tree and landing on your head is probably a reasonable amount to do with health, isn't it?
No, but I'm talking about like underlying health conditions, like, oh, you've got to stop taking drugs.
Yeah, because your heart's going to stop.
Yeah, your heart, yeah, exactly. So there you go. Well, there's a theory that I'm not willing to actually put into practice.
Yeah, I was going to say, probably stay off the cigs.
Give us an email or a tweet if you're willing to be the person who smokes themselves healthy. I think that would be really interesting to do as a feature on the podcast.
Yeah, if we could just flash to a field reporter once a...
But yeah, football's coming back. Right, have you got any predictions for what's going to happen? Who have you lot got first?
So we've got Man City away, obviously.
But they've got their warm-up game, haven't they?
So it's a bit tough. So Villa, Sheffield United, Arsenal, Man City on Wednesday.
I mean, Arsenal isn't really a warm-up, is it? Because they're just like lambs to the slaughter these days. They lost to Brentford today.
Yeah, I mean, I have loaded my team with
Man City players.
And Arsenal players, and I've got all out.
Are you not going to get a bit of John McGinn in because they play twice?
Yeah, so my double players, I've got Edison, McGinn, Grealish, De Bruyne, Aubameyang, Mahrez,
you could save yourself.
Oh my! I've got nine players.
Nine doubles. By the way, for anybody who's wondering, you know, are we football managers or something? No, this is fantasy football. This is the sort of territory that we like to roam within.
Well, Ben is currently winning our fantasy football league, so it's all gone a bit mad. So
it's all gone haywire because I mean I'm one of those who I'm going to try and put four Man United players in. I don't care that there's double game weeks available. It's Mason Greenwood's going to score hat-tricks every game.
Well, I mean, you're going to struggle because you've only played three, but...
Yeah, I know you can. Oh, but if only. I'll find a cheat code. I don't know. I am excited for the football to come back, man. Like, I am going to watch every single game. And how many games are there on Saturday? Is it five in a row?
Yeah, I think there's definitely one Friday night and one Monday night. So I imagine it's four Saturday, four Sunday.
Just perfect.
Yeah, man.
A lot of people have said, I'm never going to get this time again, you know, with lockdown and stuff. It's never going to happen again. So I'm just going to make the most of it. And so, yeah, I'm going to put a telly in the garden.
That's class. I mean, I wish I had a garden just to do that, to be fair.
Oh, I'm going to put a telly in the yard. Calling it garden is a bit a bit grandiose for what we've got going on.
I'm going to put a TV out of my window, like on the balcony.
That's rock and roll, that is. Keith Richards.
Yeah, Keith Richards, man.
Right. Right, so, you know what? It's a good thing. We didn't do a traditional show and tell this week, but that doesn't really matter because we've gone for it. So, Premier League, we're saying Liverpool going to win the league at Everton. Yeah.
Maybe not at Everton. I think there'll be surprises, obviously. I think with there being no fans and stuff, I think that a lot of the wide favourites in games will win more heavily.
Yeah.
I think the closer games that you wouldn't expect...
The derbies.
Will be shorter. Yeah. Will be shorter prices. So it'll be interesting. Like, I'm not saying we're going to go to Man City and win, but I think...
You're thinking it, though.
No, I do think there'll be surprises elsewhere.
You did beat City on their title defence season. You beat them in the opening game of the season, didn't you?
I'm not sure it was opening game of the season. We beat 1-0, George Boyd scored.
Yeah, I watched that. Yeah, that was open. I'm sure, but you know what?
It was like February, mid-Feb.
Maybe it was a different kind of season then.
But yeah, it's going to be good. I mean, I am a hypocrite for wanting to watch it all, but...
No, you're not. Like, this is the thing. People need to be able to admit that they can change their mind about things, or I believe this in principle, but in reality, this is, without getting too deep.
Yeah, 100%.
Like, I think the culture of being able to change your mind, it's like, oh, well, you thought this a week ago. It's like, well, yeah.
And also, they know what they're doing, don't they? How do they win me over? Well, Will Hill sent me a free bet 2 days before. And Sky, BT and BBC will come together and make sure all the games are able to be watched.
And Now TV come grovelling, like, oh, come back to us, come back to us. They're like, you know, you charge 40 quid a month for your services and then you were trying to keep me on whilst there was no football. Don't you come back to me.
I mean, not to... Well, everyone should get the violins out for me, but I signed my new 2-year BT and Sky deal 1 week before lockdown, not even thinking about it.
Right, I got a subscription card or a membership card to a local pub, which meant that I got like whatever percent off, and that was the week before lockdown. It cost me a tenner and I felt hard done to. You've really taken this one. You win.
Is it lifetime cheap beers though?
Lifetime cheap beers, yeah. And it also means that you can play pool and snooker on Tix, which is pretty cool.
What pub is it?
It's a snooker club next to my work.
Ah, nice.
Yeah. They play the football, but they have the tellies about 20 foot off the ground and they have really low seats. Like, they've tried to make it look chic and stuff, but, you know, neck problems aren't for everyone.
I mean, we've already mentioned the Hayworth, but in terms of layout for football, that's hard to beat as a football-watching pub with the big screen.
The Hayworth Arms in Hull. We'd actually like to give them a bit of like positivity because we weren't great clientele and they did put money into our sports club.
Neither of us are allowed in, but it is an excellent pub.
Do you know what's terrible is when you get a lifetime ban and then you give it what you would assume would be a lifetime ban's worth of time and then you go back in and you get told, no, sorry, like you're still not allowed in there, mate.
So mine was, 5 years later, we had a Sunday session.
5 years.
And the lady came over and she went, "Hiya, James, really good to see you. Like, I played on their pool team and, like, we used to drink in Eddie, sponsored us for a couple of years, whatever." And
yeah,
she came over and said, "Really good to see you. You're okay drinking here today, but the manager's in tomorrow and I think you're still barred." I was like, it's 5 years ago. And it was for not me being sick in a toilet.
It was your under yeah, your jurisdiction. Yeah, yeah.
And so I was like, "Yeah, don't worry. I'm literally come to her once a year. I think I'll be all right. I'm not going to come in on a Monday afternoon and be like, 'Hey mate, is the general manager here?' Because 5 years ago, one of my mates was sick."
I've got a bone to pick with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's good football. I mean, you'd take any pub, wouldn't you? I mean, if we're going into the pubs of Hull, there was one called Cannon Junction, which was a train set of train carriages underneath a bridge by a main road. I watch football in there these days.
I'm gonna go out on a limb.
Yeah.
Say, factoring in price, decor, entertainment.
Oh, come on.
Booze.
No.
Everything.
No. Right, anywhere you can get 20 Jager bombs for 20 quid. It doesn't have to be in a ramshackled old train that looked like it'd be better off being piled into the wall it was next to.
It's the top three pubs I've ever been in. I've said it now. Done.
I suppose it's unique. I'll give it that. And
we'll post some videos this week of stuff that's happening there. There's.
Will we? We witnessed people smoking crack in the back of that place, James.
There's the time when we bought a three-piece suite from the charity shop and got it delivered into the beer garden once. Or the time when there's 50 people with the tops off singing Party Rock Anthem. Or the time when
we bought
250 Jager bombs in there. Or loads, so many times. So many times.
Okay, fair enough. I take it back, but it would be a shit pub to watch football in, which was my point.
Oh, 100%, yeah.
But I would take watching football in there right now.
Yeah, there's something about it in Ford Super Sunday. Well, not even Ford Super Sunday anymore, is it? Renault Super Sunday? Nissan Super Sunday?
I think it's Toyota Yaris Super Sunday, isn't it, in accordance with what we'll all be driving these days.
Yeah, I mean, make sure we're only driving one car.
I'm going to have to go for a wee.
Okay, so this is
the
break.
Yeah, this is the break. I'm going to take it off.
first one.
Right, so I reckon we've done the Premier League. Now it's time to turn to the fictional league that we were talking about that last week. And I wanted to, so this is a part of my show and tell, I suppose. It's which celebrities we want to get involved in Soccer Aid. Now, I really enjoyed Soccer Aid when I went. I don't think I actually told the story last week, but I've got a history of doing this as well. I just sound absolutely useless when we're talking like this. But Beck and I went to Soccer Aid a couple of years ago, and it's held at Old Trafford. And so, perfect, nice, easy train from Macclesfield. Big up Macclesfield. And yeah, it just dead simple. Got there. They allowed us in, and it was like, right, what time's kickoff? And I look at the ticket. And it turns out we got in there like 4 hours before it started. And then we're like, oh no, do you mind if we go outside and, you know, sort of go and do something else? And they were like, no, sorry, once you're in, you're in. So just make yourselves comfortable. So like, right, so we went to the bar and said, excuse me, you know, with this offer you've got on, which is 4 items for £12, instead of the crisps and the pies, can we just sub them out for beers? And the lad looked at us for a second, like, and we thought, you know, we were going to be told, no, that's ridiculous. Absolutely not. Like, that's not how it works. He goes, yeah, sure, why not? I don't care. Like, perfect. Can I have 12 bit or however many it was, you know, all the items for £12? And so we kept doing that time after time after time after time. And then we went back about just before kickoff and we were like, excuse me, could we, like, you know, like you do when you get a good barman, usher the person over and wait for them. And then somebody comes to serve you, like, no, it's okay. It's okay. He's got our order. It's all right. It's fine. And he comes over and he tries to serve us again and the till breaks. And so we're trying to get I think it must have been 6 beers for £12, which in Old Trafford is awesome.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Six Budweisers as well, solid beers. And yeah, he says, sorry guys, till's broke. So like, oh God, so we've got a queue again. He was like, nah, just have him. So my Soccer Aid experience, I can't really remember what happened. All I can remember is that going to the toilet multiple times a half is really infuriating for the rest of the people who are there.
It does sound ideal, though. I mean, you've gone to Soccer Aid, not watched any of the entertainment, and had a load of cheap beers.
Well, actually, you say not watched any of the entertainment, but there was a band whose name I forget. I can't even think what they're called. Some pop band. Jonas Blue. There you go. I was thinking Jonas Brothers, but if it was Jonas Brothers, I would have 100% stayed sober and had my arm in the air. That would have been fantastic. Jonas Blue were on beforehand, so I enjoyed that while I could remember it. And yeah, I watched enough to sort of have a general idea. But we're going to tell you now which celebrities we want to see in Soccer Aid. And I think, James, yours are all off the cuff this week, aren't they?
Yeah, just travel. I think I'm very much a go with the flow with this.
Yeah. So I've got a few written down. So I'll start with a proper obvious one. This man probably lays claim to being the coolest bloke in the world at the moment, I would say. I think the coolest job you can possibly have is being either a footballer or guitarist in a really successful rock band. And Serge from Kasabian, Leicester lad, turns up and yeah, he gets put through one-on-one, well, edge of the box by, I think it's Zidane, which is in itself quite cool, playing for the rest of the world against England. And Serge from Kasabian, I mean, only one man that I can think of has done this so successfully. He chips David Seaman when nobody expected it. And the other man's Ronaldinho. I mean,
2002 World Cup.
Well, this is 2012. Arguably more important than that World Cup's goal.
I was probably less devastated that Seaman conceded that goal at Soccer Aid than I was when he conceded the goal at the World Cup.
Right, so we were at school at that point. So how did you watch it? Because they wheeled the TV into our hall.
Yeah, I think we had to go in early, didn't we? But I remember being in the biology room and it was on. We wheeled the TV in.
It was devastating time. Because it was a bit of that North Korea type thing where it's like, right, we don't usually do this, but for one game only, we'll let us all watch. And then, North Korea did it with Portugal when they got absolutely obliterated. And, you know, likewise, I don't think football games are played at schools anymore because of that lob.
Well, Yeah, I mean, for me, it's not hard. And I'm going to start this campaign now, is that any time England are playing in a World Cup or European Championship, that day, the entirety of the day should be a national holiday.
Okay. I don't think you're going to struggle for signatures on a petition. I think you're going to struggle for it to be actually implemented.
I don't see why not, mate. I think... Think about it. Beers, barbecue, football. Yeah.
Which of those do you think that the current government are going to say, right, okay, these are really important, sod schools and going to work?
Do you not hear me, mate? Beers, barbecue, and football.
Ah, it's, no, it's actually, yeah, important. When you put it like that, yeah.
It's going, on one hand, going to work for a day, or B, watching football and drinking.
Everything you want.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let me put you on the spot. Who do you want? Either former footballer or a celebrity in Soccer Aid?
Oh, putting me on the spot. I'm going to go for a couple of Johnny Depp characters.
Characters. Captain Jack Sparrow tracking back running like that.
So my centre half, Captain Jack Sparrow.
Oh, don't say goalkeeper.
Goalkeeper, I'd like to be Edward Scissorhands, please.
Right, okay, well, you can have one of the goalkeepers. Is Edward Scissorhands... Well, he can't be English, can he?
I must be rest of the world at the moment.
So you're rest of the world. Can I pick the goalkeeper for England?
Go on.
Right, I want to dispel the rumour that I created in episode one about female goalkeepers being rubbish. I want to put Gemma Collins in net because nothing is getting past her.
Not even that joke. Yeah.
Problem? Right.
She's overrated, isn't she?
Well, no, actually, I got into watching her programme recently because, The Real Housewives and all that sort of thing. Beck does watch it, but she, like you were saying earlier, like with Friends being something easy to watch in the background, she likes watching things that you don't have to pay attention to, whereas I like something that you do have to pay attention to. And so when we watch Coronation Street together, I'm like, oh, who's that? What they do? Who are they related to? Why is that person cheating on that person? Do they not love each other anymore? Oh, that boy's really ill. You know, like little things like that.
I mean, a lot of me is hurt that you still watch soaps. That's going to have to be a...
Is that
Beck's influence? Or...
At this point, I think I'm more keen than her. If you get into it, mate, it's a bit like smoking, right? You can avoid it. If you just avoid it and nobody you know does it, then you're not going to do it. But if all your mates are doing it, your girlfriend's doing it. But yeah, anyway. No, the Gemma Collins, like, to be fair, she was very bold. So when the lockdown came about, she was like, in her typical fashion, like, I don't even care. I'm going to be a diva, even though I can't go outside. And we watched some episodes of her programme and it was the most diabolical watching you've ever seen. It was they put some waders on her and get her to go and get in her brother's pond because that was entertainment. And it was hilarious.
Oh, great.
She mowed the lawn in one episode, which was, fucking brilliant on a ride on mower.
Is that a euphemism or?
Mowed the lawn.
She actually mowed grass.
Yeah. Probably. If she was trimming her pubes, it would have been hilarious to watch. But no, there was none of that.
Gemma Collins, man. That's, I like that.
She'd go for it as well. Bit of publicity,
I'm going to have to put Ramsey's a staple, isn't he? You've got to have Ramsey in there, I think.
Well, this is it. The Soccer Aid staple. So he plays for rest of the world because he's Scottish, apparently.
Yeah, lives in the south of England.
Or it sounds like he's from the south of England.
Businesses are based in London, yeah.
Yeah, but for the...
Scottish
for the purposes of that. And you're trying to say that he wouldn't put beans and eggs together.
I mean, if you're doing this England team, you've got to spend the day with Robbie Williams and what's his mate called? He's not famous. Johnny Wilkes, is it?
I've no idea. I didn't know he had a famous, non-famous mate.
Famous mate that plays all the time. Ollie Mears is in that the lot in it.
Can I just say, right, once I put a picture on Instagram and a girl commented saying, Ollie Murs lookalike, it was the best day I've ever had.
And now she's locked up.
Yeah. Yeah, she's actually recently found out she's got glaucoma and can't see.
Love is blind, mate.
Right, okay, so I'm doing the England team, which works really well for... right, I'm going to say... Having watched Soccer Aid, like, some of them look like professional footballers and some of them look like, you know, absolute, just atrocious. Mark Wright at left back. You know, the only way is Essex, Mark Wright.
Yeah, he's married to...
Corrie Girl. What's her name?
Keegan, Michelle Keegan.
Why am I thinking Kim Kardashian? Like, I just knew it had a K in it.
I can't see Kim K just walking down... Corey's just walking into Roy's Rolls for a...
Imagine that crossover episode, though. No, Mark Wright, right? So
breaking internet, mate.
But he's stunningly good-looking. Like, we can all appreciate that. Man crush Mark. He plays left-back, which nobody wants to play left-back, so fair play to him. He is actually left-footed, scored an absolute screamer of a free kick in the in previous games. So... You know, yeah, I'm having Mark Wright in my team.
And what I've done there is just listen to you for 5 minutes rather than think of anybody else. So you've now put me on the spot.
Can I pick a player for you then?
100%.
Okay, right. So, I mean, stop me wherever you think is appropriate. But I know there's a perfect player. So what you need in your team, having picked who you've picked, you need an athlete, don't you? Somebody who's willing to get up and down the pitch. Maybe they don't contribute that much to the actual gameplay, but you need somebody who... And also, a high profile, yeah? So, you're not selling many tickets based on who you've said already. Oscar Pistorius is at Elise End.
I've got Edward Scissorhands and Captain Jack Sparrow on my side. I'm going to be fine for ticket sales.
Okay, fair enough. Well, Oscar Pistorius is at a loose end at the moment, and I think he'd be fantastic for your team. He gets up and down the pitch really well, and with those pegs on his feet, he won't be able to shoot.
It depends what we're getting. Are we getting 3 a.m. startled Oscar Pistorius, or are we getting regular day-to-day good guy Oscar Pistorius?
Now, I don't know how much sort of law training that you've had or how South African you are, but I don't know how we differentiate between the two. We're definitely having legs on Oscar because otherwise he'd be absolutely dreadful. But yeah, Oscar Pistorius is playing up front for you lot.
I've got a lot of time for it.
Yeah.
I do think football talent wise, I'm struggling. Ticket sales, I've nailed it though.
Well, yeah. The soap stars, you know, they don't really sell it, do they? And like the YouTube sensations that are always on.
You want to go film star or controversial, don't you?
Oh, like, you want Terry Crews and The Rock, don't you? But you'll settle for... I mean, The Rock supports Mac Town. We've already said that. So he was not spreading his allegiances to any other team.
Yeah, I mean, for me, and this is a decent segue, actually. For me, I'd move away from Soccer Aid, and I think it's actually time for Shrovetide Aid.
Oh my God.
Could you imagine the scenes?
Oh, without even thinking about it, we need to do a little bit on this next week. I mean, here's me calling most of the nation pedos for watching normal people when we could have actually been getting onto something decent.
Shrovetide Aid. If people think it's a good idea, we're in.
Shrovetide Aid. And you just, turn up and there's an honesty policy? You just pay £2 somehow?
We'll have a box.
Okay,
Gemma Collins can captain the South.
Oh, do you know what else would be really good?
And we'll get a famous Northerner. Give us your famous Northerners.
Paddy McGuinness.
Freddie Flintoff and Paddy McGuinness.
Oh, man. What about also... What celebrity boxing matches would you like to see?
Oh, that's interesting, isn't it?
No, we're not doing it now. It's just, this is a mental note for later on.
This is a message to future James, what boxing would you like to see?
Also, it's a message to all of the people who are listening. Can you just message in which boxing matches you'd like to see between celebrities? Try not to make it awful, you know, but I mean, if you want to see Jerry McCann beat up the News of the World, MD, like, fair enough. Don't worry, I'll edit this silence out.
No, that's fine. Should we move on to the...
Yeah, man. Right.
Do this. We're going to have to edit quite a bit of this, aren't we?
Yeah, I tell you what, I wish I wasn't as drunk as I was so that it would be easier. So now we come to probably the bit that everybody looks forward to the least, but that we look forward to the most, the Guinness game. And this is to decide the top three for next week. This week is a week with a difference. So I've been playing with a handicap previously. I've been putting a bit of blue tack on a normal glass. I'd like to say a massive thank you to Bet for getting me a normal Guinness glass so we can actually prove where I'm up to when I'm drinking it. So,
congratulations, James, mate. I mean, it's four weeks in. I think we're making progress.
We are making progress. This will be probably the hardest episode to edit, you know, with all of the toilet breaks and me saying things that I'm not allowed to say. So, would you like me to start or would you like to go first?
I think as the champion, mate, you can start.
My God, I've never been called that before. I relish that. Right. So.
So.
I'm going to put this facing me so I can't cheat. Between the Guinness and the harp.
So he started drinking. Couple of swigs. Still looking awkwardly into the webcam. I think that's an overshoot, but he's put the glass down.
Nice. It's an overshoot by at least 2 millimetres, 3 millimetres.
Should show it to the camera, mate.
Oh, sorry, yes.
Ooh. So we are talking bottom of the letters for that, guys. But even when he tries to make it good,
tilt it towards the camera so it looks like it's gone in.
I think my problem has been, and I've been speaking to my Guinness drinking coach, Alex Calder, on this, is I overthink it. So what I'm going to do is just do one big gulp.
You can't one gulp that amount. Can we also, a bit of a tag, Alex Calder, brewer of Calder Balm Imperial IPA, 8%, absolutely delicious. The first time I tried it, I only drank the alcohol off the top because it had separated. The second time, having given it a bit of a stir, beautiful. Thank you very much.
This is it. Now, Ben just gets, any breweries that contact us now, Ben just gets sent beer. Calder sends Ben beer. Nothing makes its way to Shipley.
Well, yeah, now, I mean, we've not been sent any beer yet, but I think there's some on the way.
I'm going to go for this. Like I said, I'm just going to do one gulp, I think.
I really think, well, you can do one gulp and we'll see how it goes. We've got a lot of time to practice.
Maybe that's my thing.
Maybe you're one gulp, James. Like
one gulp guy.
A one gulp guy. Okay, so he puts his glass to the lips, and I mean, it was so fast I couldn't even commentate on it. And he's looking at it with a bit of regret, maybe regret, or maybe it's pride. I'm not sure. Oh my God!
Very close. I've definitely won this week.
I mean, he's self-proclaimed won this week. I'd say we're pretty similar, but I think it should be. It should be like golf. If you do it in less. I did it in two gulps, you did it in one, so I think that should bring your score down.
It's just closest wins, and I think that makes it 2-2.
2-2 in the lifetime standings.
And we will post, I will have a think, post on Monday or Tuesday this week about what we're going to do top three wise.
Ooh, yeah, we need to get you guys involved. So, like, anybody who's listening who wants to get involved, give us an opinion on what you want to hear us give a top three on. As you can tell, I mean, we're not even doing this like devil's advocate or I think one thing, you think another thing on purpose. It just tends to naturally be where we lie.
And hopefully all of this should be, you should be able to see us visually on YouTube, etc.
Yeah, so if you want to see what the difference is between letting somebody who's not a barber cut your hair and not cutting your hair at all, you'll see which side of the argument that you're on. I look a disgrace. James has had his hair cut.
Or if you want to see what me having to close all the windows in the house to stop the stop us hearing the traffic on the podcast sound.
Hey, in the pre-record when we're getting ourselves together and we're listening to woo woo. That's a camp. That's a camp ambulance. That is, isn't
downtown
it?
S-Town, mate. That's the boy. Like, it is warm in here.
Yeah.
Should we move on to any other business?
Yeah. Have you got any other business?
Just to remind people, just to like and share stuff that we've got. It really does mean a lot to us when you post stuff.
I get so carried away. I mean, like, whenever, if anybody texts me saying I like this, I like that, the other. If we get retweeted by anybody, I text James saying like, mate, we've made it, and he's like, yeah, I mean, like, slowly, you know, not quite yet. So yeah, it's so appreciated by the two of us, any getting in touch.
And thank you to the breweries that have been in touch. We've got quite a few good surprises over the next few weeks for you guys.
Yeah, Rick from Spotlight, thank you very much for sending the beers that are currently in transit. Like, really appreciate that. And we'll give them the full review once they arrive. I'm going to ruin the surprise, but Storm Brewer in Macclesfield have given the okay. They want to get involved. Not sure if they're going to co-host or interview, but we'll see how that goes.
And then hopefully we should be in touch with Salt Air next week, Salt the week after, also Cross Bay. Big shout out to Robert Cross Bay. So we'll see, and hopefully you guys will have a lot of content, especially the beer stuff. We want to get as many voices and your opinions on beers that you like, where we should be going with stuff.
Like, definitely.
It's great us having two brains on it and looking at trying beers, but the more you get involved and the more...
It's what we're all about. We want this to do well, and we want to buy Blazers at 1,000 downloads, and we're at 235 or so. So, you know, we need to just keep this going. But we absolutely love doing it. I am absolutely steaming.
So look forward to this edit, guys. I mean, if the edit is has turned out as well as I hope it has, then you know where to point the finger.
I mean, well, we'll see how it goes, but. Just, yeah, massive thank you to everybody who's listening. I can't believe that people are listening to us for an hour and a bit, but there you go. Absolutely love it. Love you all. Speak to you soon. Cheers emoji. Speak to you later.
See you later, guys. Thank you.
Cheers.